about the parsonage. Judy McNeil talked to me this morning, and I've talked to Pastor Jim. They started cleaning. They've only had four people help on one day, and they've got quite a bit left to do. And it's not a dirty mess. It's just getting it prepared and ready for them to move in. They're going to do today at 1 o'clock, tomorrow morning starting at 9 a.m. If you can help, bring cleaning supplies, rags, and buckets. Pastor Jim is planning to do a day trip Tuesday. He wants to go to Eldon and survey damage there and also bring some stuff. And then I think he plans on staying in the parsonage Wednesday night. So we're kind of under a time frame here. So if anybody can help, that would be appreciated.
Okay. Also looking at the calendar, we have some birthdays this week. Patty Derflinger is celebrating today. On the 29th, it's Lachlan Williams' birthday. On the 30th, Jerry Thomas, Deb Canock, and Bethany Canock are all celebrating. And on July 1st, it's Ryan Kern's birthday. I don't have any anniversaries listed, so let's sing happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
All right. Remember our upcoming events. Bible school is happening July 25th, 26th, 27th. Bible school at Eldon is the 26th through the 30th in conjunction with the Christian Church. And August 1st, Elvis returns. So we'll get to enjoy Junior Tally on the lawn and more ice cream. So ice cream is always a good thing. Are there any other announcements? If not, let us join together in an attitude of worship as we sing our praise chorus, Alleluia. Would you please stand and join together in the printed call to worship? In returning and rest, you shall be saved, that he may teach us his ways and that we may walk in his paths. Let us join together in hymn number 474, Precious Lord, Take My Hand.
Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand. I am tired, I am weak. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand. Precious Lord, linger near.
Let us join together in prayer. O God, in mystery and silence, you are present in our lives, bringing new life out of destruction, hope out of despair, growth out of difficulty. We thank you that you do not leave us alone, but labor to make us whole. Help us to perceive your unseen hand in the unfolding of our lives and to attend to the gentle guidance of your Spirit, that we may know the joy you give your people. Amen. You may be seated. For our scripture readings this morning, we'll start with Psalm 130, and we will read it responsibly from the hymnal, page 848. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplications. If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, Lord, who could stand? But there is forgiveness with you, that you may be worshiped. I wait for the Lord. My soul waits. In the Lord's word I hope. My soul waits for the Lord more than those who watch for the morning, more than those who watch for the morning. O Israel, hope is in the Lord, for with the Lord there is steadfast love, with the Lord is plenteous redemption, and the Lord will redeem Israel from all iniquities. In my distress, and from the Old Testament today, I'll be reading from the second book of Samuel, chapter 1, verse 1, then verses 17 through 27. In your pew Bibles, it's on page 467. After the death of Saul, David returned from striking down the Amalekites and stayed in Ziklag 2 days. David took up this lament concerning Saul and his son Jonathan, and he ordered that the people of Judah be taught this lament of the bow. It is written in the book of Jashar. A gazelle lies slain on your heights, Israel. How the mighty have fallen. Tell it not in Gath. Proclaim it not in the streets of Ashkelon, lest the daughters of the Philistines be glad. Lest the daughters of the uncircumcised rejoice. Mountains of Gilboa, may you have neither dew nor rain. May no showers fall on your terraced fields, for there the shield of the mighty was despised, the shield of Saul, no longer rubbed with oil. From the blood of the slain, from the flesh of the mighty, the bow of Jonathan did not turn back. The sword of Saul did not return unsatisfied. Saul and Jonathan, in life they were loved and admired, and in death they were not parted. They were swifter than eagles. They were stronger than lions. Daughters of Israel, weep for Saul, who clothed you in scarlet and finery, who adorned your garments with ornaments of gold. How the mighty have fallen in battle. Jonathan lies slain on your heights. I grieve for you, Jonathan, my brother. You were very dear to me. Your love for me was wonderful, more wonderful than that of women. How the mighty have fallen. The weapons of war have perished. And from the New Testament, I'll be reading from the book of 2 Corinthians, chapter 8, verses 7 through 15. In your pew Bibles, it's on page 1799. But since you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in complete earnestness, and in the love we have kindled in you, see that you also excel in this grace of giving. I am not commanding you, but I want to test the sincerity of your love by comparing it with the earnestness of others. For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that you through his poverty might become rich. And here is my judgment about what is best for you in this matter. Last year, you were the first not only to give, but also to have the desire to do so. Now finish the work so that your eager willingness to do it may be matched by your completion of it according to your means. For if the willingness is there, the gift is acceptable according to what one has, not according to what one does not have. Our desire is not that others might be relieved while you are hard-pressed, but that there might be equality. At the present time, your plenty will supply what they need, so that in turn their plenty will supply what you need. The goal is equality. As it is written, the one who gathered much did not have too much, and the one who gathered little did not have too little. And our gospel reading this morning comes from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 5, verses 21 through 43. In your pew Bibles, it's on page 1563. When Jesus had again crossed over by boat to the other side of the lake, a large crowd gathered around him while he was by the lake. Then one of the synagogue leaders, named Jairus, came, and when he saw Jesus, he fell at his feet. He pleaded earnestly with him, "My little daughter is dying. Please come and put your hands on her so that she will be healed and live." So Jesus went with him. A large crowd followed and pressed around him, and a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years. She had suffered a great deal under the care of many doctors and had spent all she had, yet instead of getting better, she grew worse. When she heard about Jesus, she came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak, because she thought, "If I just touch his clothes, I will be healed." Immediately her bleeding stopped, and she felt in her body that she was freed from her suffering. At once Jesus realized that power had gone out from him. He turned around in the crowd and asked, "Who touched my clothes?" "You see the people crowding against you," his disciples answered, "and yet you can ask, 'Who touched me?'" But Jesus kept looking around to see who had done it. Then the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came and fell at his feet and, trembling with fear, told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace and be freed from your suffering." While Jesus was still speaking, some people came from the house of Jairus, the synagogue leader. "Your daughter is dead," they said. "Why bother the teacher anymore?" Overhearing what they said, Jesus told him, "Don't be afraid, just believe." He did not let anyone follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they came to the home of the synagogue leader, Jesus saw a commotion with people crying and wailing loudly. He went in and said to them, "Why all this commotion and wailing? The child is not dead, but asleep." But they laughed at him. After he put them all out, he took the child's father and mother, the disciples who were with him, and went in where the child was. He took her by the hand and said to her, "Talitha cum," which means, "Little girl, I say to you, get up." Immediately the girl stood up and began to walk around. She was 12 years old. At this time they were completely astonished. He gave strict orders not to let anyone know about this and told them to give her something to eat. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Good morning. I was here with you last Sunday, Pastor Kelly's last week. We come down occasionally. Diana's my wife. That's the daughter of Roger Johnson. So, if you love Roger, hallelujah. If you don't, don't hold it against me. It's always a pleasure to come and to, it's always a pleasure to come and to worship with you and to be with you. In some ways, it's like coming home. Amen? It's always good to come home. So I looked at Deb and I said, this is after the worship. Kind of seemed a little morning. Pastor Kelly was leaving, and that most of you got along well with Pastor Kelly, and it was kind of a sad day. And I looked at Deb and I said, what am I supposed to preach on next week? She says, what do you think we need? And I said, well, right now I would give the sermon title, Mourn and Move On. Mourn and Move On. She called me in the middle of the week and she said, what are you preaching on? And I said, I don't know, what idea did I have last Sunday? And she said, preach on that. Mourn and Move On. And I said, I'll do that. And I chose Genesis 50. It is a story of Joseph and his brothers. It's the end of the story. Raise your hand if you know a little bit about Joseph. Coat of many colors, fought a lot with his brothers, one of the most dysfunctional families in all of Scripture. Joseph is sold by his brothers, sold into slavery. Experts say that Joseph probably spent 14 to 16 years in jail for things that he never did. This guy is tested over and over and over and over by God. Life is not kind to him. Joseph felt like the people of the Eldon United Methodist Church. It stunk there this morning. I said to them this morning, it stinks in here this morning, and they all said amen. They all realized it. They told me right away when I walked in the door. And I said, that's appropriate, because we're going to read a story from Scripture today, and Joseph, his life really did stink. It started off really well with this coat of many colors, but it goes downhill in a hurry. It's like a 9-inch rain overnight. It is bad news for Joseph. He's accused of all kinds of things. He asks people, like he interprets someone's dream, and he goes, don't forget about me, don't forget about me. And what happens? They forget about him. At the end of the story, Joseph rises to power. He saves millions of people from starvation, because he is in a position of power where he gives food away. First he says, let's hold on to the food, then we'll have food to give away to hungry people. So in a position of power, Joseph's brothers, who have sold him to slavery, they come before him, and Joseph recognizes them right away. He could have put them to death. He could have tortured them. He could have kicked them out and said, no food for you. The things that might have gone through his mind, I probably know some of those things because I have five brothers. Do any of you have five brothers or close to it? 95% of the time we get along really well. The other 5%, things go through my mind like, God, smite him. God, pay him back for what he has done. You'll get yours Anybody ever thought things like that before? God will get even with you, buddy. And Joseph forgives them and gives them food. It's a beautiful ending to the story, but now in Genesis 50, the old man passes away and the brothers are like, uh-oh, now we're going to get it. When Joseph's brothers saw that their father was dead, they said, what if Joseph holds a grudge against us and pays us back for all the wrongs that we have done to him? So they sent word to Joseph, saying, your father left these instructions before he died. This is what you are to say to Joseph. I ask you to forgive your brothers the sins and the wrongs they committed in treating you so badly. Now please forgive the sins of the servants of the God of your father. When their message came to him, Joseph wept. His brothers came and threw themselves down before him. We are your slaves, they said. But Joseph said to them, don't be afraid. Am I in the place of God? You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good, to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. The King James Version says, and it's probably what we are most familiar with, you meant it for evil, but God meant it for good, just so that I could be in this position to save so many lives from starvation. So then, don't be afraid. I will provide for you and your children. And he reassured them and spoke kindly to them. Let's pray. God, we pray that as we read through your word and we study it, that you will change us. More than just healing, might it be transformational. More than just sounding good, might it change our hearts. Oh God, we are stubborn people, and at times we need the doors of our hearts pried open. Oh God, through the power of your Spirit, pry open our hearts that we might receive your goodness. We need you, God, and we need your word. We pray that you would bless us this day with your word. We pray it in your holy name, Jesus, and God's people said, amen. I'm a college chaplain. I've been a chaplain for 21 years now. I hang out with 18-year-olds. So I like looking out and seeing some gray hair. Or no hair. We have a strong Christian community at Central. We do all kinds of things. We have bowling nights and we have small groups. It's like youth group on steroids. We have all kinds of things that college students can do. This last semester during finals week, I had a young freshman girl come up to me and she said, this place would be awesome except for the test. I'm like, yeah, I don't even know why they have classes. You could just pay to come to hang out. That would be awesome, wouldn't it? This place would be awesome if it wasn't for the test. Faith would be awesome if it wasn't for, church. You get to hang out, potlucks, harvest suppers, ice cream. Your worship leader over here was mumbling. I don't know if you can hear. It's always better with ice cream. It, church would be awesome if it wasn't for the test. We need to talk about it. We don't want to talk about it, but we need to talk about it. Enough of the test already. I mean, Pastor Kelly should be standing right here preaching today. Amen? No more test. Eighth grade math was fun, wasn't it? Raise your hand if you loved eighth grade math. I remember Mr. Emmert. He taught in Pella. I remember two things about Mr. Emmert. He collected erasers. You know those erasers that are about like this big? You know what I'm talking about? He saved them, and he'd have them behind his desk. And if you weren't paying attention, I mean, you'd get fired for this today, he would just grab one of those erasers and whoosh. I remember the first time he beamed me on the side of the head. I wasn't paying attention. And he'd smile at you. And I'm like, you can't do that. And he'd say, yes, I can. I'm the teacher. Second thing I remember about Mr. Emmert, he'd come in and every grade once in a while he'd say, we got a quiz today. And the whole class would say, you can't do that. And he'd go, yes, I can. I'm the teacher. We need to talk about tests of faith that come to us. We don't talk about it enough. But God gives us tests of faith. And they're usually not a lot of fun. About as much fun as 9 inches of rain overnight. Usually our first reaction is something like, God, you can't do that. I had to check passages that have to do with God testing people. Deuteronomy 8:2, Psalm 7:9, Jeremiah 11:20, Psalm 11:5. When I Googled it last night, 25 most popular scripture passages about God testing your faith. I thought, I wonder if there's any more. So I thought, let's Google a little bit more. And then I came up with the next 50. This place would be awesome if there were no test. We just baptize people. It'd be awesome, amen? Have another potluck. It'd be awesome, amen? Little more ice cream. It would be awesome, amen? We could hold hands and sing hallelujah. But the test, Mr. Emmert would say, I want to know if you're learning anything. Can it be that when we come here every Sunday, and we come so we can grow in our faith, that we trust God more and more and more with everything in our lives. That occasionally God says, I want to know if you've learned anything. It is so hard to say as a preacher that God has the right, he has the ability, he has the privilege, because he's King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and if he wants to test me today, he can test me. And it's a pretty good thing to review that and have that run through your mind before things fall apart. What we see in Joseph at the end of the whole saga, the end of the story, that is, he isn't fighting back against God. He doesn't say, "Why did you guys sell me? Why did you lie to our dad and say that I was killed by a wild beast? Why? Have you even forgotten about me? When you came in here before me, you didn't even know it was me. Why?" What we find with Joseph is he is not pushing back against God. He isn't shaking his fist at heaven going, "Why did you have me spend all of those years in prison?" What we find with Joseph is a man who says, "You meant it all for evil, and God brought it all around for good." He was the very first one hinting at the New Testament truth. All things work together for, say it, good. All things work together for good for those who love God and are called according to his purposes. I said to the people in Eldon this morning, it takes a lot of faith to walk down in your basement that smells the way that it does, having about 5 inches of water in their basement, worshiping with a lot of people had their mouths and noses covered. It takes a lot of faith to say somehow God will bring something good from this. And the parsonage next door is no exception. Amen. How can God do anything good with that? You either trust him or you don't. You either say God's got this. I think the opposite of that is you would just run away and say, forget it. What I love about the story of Joseph is like life is a test and another test and another test. And he keeps rising to the occasion of saying, God is going to work it out. Absolutely incredible to me. I think I would have given up when I got sold into slavery. I might have given up when I sat in jail forever. I might have given up when I was falsely accused of rape. I might have given up. How many times could Joseph have just given up? But every time he goes, all things will work together for good. Joseph hangs on to a sovereign God, an all-knowing God, a God who holds the world in his hands. Remember that song? Used to sing it way back in Sunday school. If you grew up in Sunday school, Zacchaeus. Remember all those kids' songs, Zacchaeus? They all had actions. They were the awesome ones. They all had an action. If it had an action, you loved it. If it didn't have an action, you went, why are we singing this? Zacchaeus was a wee little man, and wee little man was he. Or I loved, we are climbing Jacob's ladder. I didn't even know who Jacob was, but I knew he had a ladder, and you just climbed it. He's got the whole world. He's got the whole world. In his hands. Some people don't like to sing. Some people don't know the song. And some people are looking at me like, you ain't making me sing, buddy. I love that song. And as a kid with a childlike faith, you can just sing it. He's got the whole world in his hands. But do you sing that in the middle of a test? You know, you get down to the bottom line really quick when you got water running into your basement. When you're sitting in the hospital and the doctor uses words like cancer. You get to the bottom line really, really quick. God's either got this world in his hands or he's out to lunch. What I love about Joseph, he will not be obsessed with what he thinks is right. He leaves it up to God. He will not be obsessed with his own controlling and pulling all the levers himself. He lets God do all of it. What I love about Joseph is he will just give it all to God. I checked with Max Lucado, one of my favorite authors. Max is an incredible, incredible author. I checked with him on this passage. You meant it for evil, God meant it for good. And really the Hebrew words that are used in that are weaving. Ladies, if you've ever made like a quilt or a fabric or anything, it's kind of like we're weaving something that we think is right, and then God comes and he reweaves it. He remakes it. My mom is huge into quilting, and she goes, this block will go here, and this block will go here. The only thing wrong with that picture is she has 6 boys and no girls. You know how many times I've listened to my mom talking about this quilt block is going to go here, and then this, don't you think this one will look good, and this will look good? And I'm like, the sense that we have, according to Max Lucado, with this whole verse, you meant it for evil, but God is going to work something good out of this. It's like, I'm going to do this block and this block and this block, and God is going, that's good, that's a nice plan, but I'm going to come and rework the whole thing. I'm going to come and reweave everything. Because I know what you need in your life. I know what's best for your life. Not once do we see Joseph going, you gotta be kidding me. What we have is a Joseph that goes, just reweave it. Rework it. Just make it be the way you want it to be, even when I don't understand. Test. We do good on some of them, don't we? I remember a couple in seminary I didn't do really good on. I was like, oops, screwed that one up. And it happens in our faith life as well. Amen? There are some times we don't understand God at all. And maybe that's why we never talk about the tests that we have in our faith walk. because it reminds us of times in life when it is really stinking hard. Every student that had Mr. Emmert absolutely loved him. When you got into high school, you went, holy cow, he really taught us a lot. This guy was really, really, really good. For about 22 years in a row, we would go to conference math tournaments in high school. I was involved in one my junior year, and we would go against all the other high schools in our conference. 22 years in a row. And the first time Pella didn't get to the top, guess who was no longer teaching? Anybody want to guess? One of his favorite phrases was, you got to figure this out. I can hear him up in front of the class. You got to figure this out. If you don't figure it out this year, when next year comes, it's going to be even harder. We didn't sing this song for fun. People were trying to plant a seed that would grow deep, deep in your hearts. He's got the whole world in his hands. And life will give us all kinds of tests. And the evil one will throw all kinds of things at it. But here, Joseph, again, you meant it for evil. God will work it for good. Not obsessed with what you think should be happening right now. A quarter inch of rain every 3 days. Or obsessed with who you think should be standing here right now. Somehow going, God, this is your church. And you're in control. Then we'll move on. Trusting. 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 I hadn't thought about Hurricane Katrina. We brought college students, Diane and I did, down to Louisiana, I don't know, probably 8-10 times. We went down a lot. We helped a church in Slidell, a little Methodist church. We were supposed to be going to a distribution center. You know, all of those health kits you prepare and they go into a warehouse. We were ready to go down and we were gonna work with some lady down there who was in charge of the warehouse. 3 days before we left, 4 days before we left, she called me up and she said, I don't want you at the warehouse. And I'm like, I've already got it on MapQuest. I'm going to the warehouse. She said, I don't want you there. Last week we were at a meeting and all the pastors were there and the pastors were talking about what they needed. It had been 2 months since the hurricane. We were on fall break. We were going to run down to New Orleans and run back. She said, I don't want you at the distribution center. I want you in Slidell, Louisiana. And I said, what's a Slidell? She said, that's a town. Like, you dummy. I said, what's there? And she said, Pastor Ernest. He broke down crying. He said to all of the families in his church, you take care of your homes. God will take care of his church. He said, nobody's touched the church in 2 months. We had 5 feet of water in the church. I said, you want us to come and gut it? He says, you come and do whatever needs to be done. I don't know. He says, I think we'll have to start from scratch. I said, is there anything that you would like me to bring along? He goes, I don't know. What do you have? 3 months before then, they replaced the pews in the chapel at Central College. They were in perfect shape. I didn't want them to do it, but they would replace some carpet in different areas, and the carpet clashed with the colors on the pews. They said, we're going to replace the pews. And I said, that's a stupid idea. Why would you want to do that? He goes, well, we'll put them in storage. When you put things in storage, that means in 10 years, what's going to happen? So I have a pastor in Slidell, Louisiana, and he goes, well, what do you have? And I said, I got some pews I don't think the college needs. He said, how many? I said, I don't know. I said, what else do you need? And he says, well, all of the tables in the Sunday school rooms are all destroyed. Do you have any of them? And I said, I don't know. I can check. I was leaving in 4 days from Pella, Iowa to Slidell, Louisiana. And he's going, bring what you can bring. I emailed somebody in the warehouse and I said, how many pews do we have? He said, I'll get back to you. And I said, today. And he goes, okay. I said, check on tables too. And he said, well, the library just replaced some tables. Some of them were a lot better than they thought, so we held on to them as well. I said, how about chairs? And he said, I'll check. I'd asked the pastor at that church to go and count the pews that he needed. Look around the church. What else would you need? About 2 hours later, my phone call, and he called me. And he says, I'm walking around in the church right now. It is black with mold. I said, don't stay there very long. And he says, well, I'm counting pews. I said, all right. And he said, I'm counting tables in Sunday school rooms. And I said, all right, make it quick. I could hear him walking. And I could hear him crying. He said, it's only the third time that I've been in the church. And I'm realizing how bad it is. I could hear him crying. And then he said, the organ will have to go, won't it? I said, yeah. And the piano? I said, yeah. He would catch his breath between crying and he said, 64! I said, 64 what? And he said, 64 pews. I've just walked all, and if you can imagine this, a water line about the same height toward the top of your windows. And he's walking around and he said, everything's covered in mold. 64. He said, we're kind of a small church. In fact, some of my pastor friends joke and say we're more the size of a chapel. And I had the first little tingling that kind of went through my body. Because what I serve at the college is a chapel. I'm talking to him and I said, what about the Sunday school rooms? And I jot 64 down on a piece of paper. He says, I need new tables. The formica on all of them is bubbled up and I could envision it, amen? We've all seen tables that have done that. And he said, all of the teachers, they'll need new chairs. They're kind of the fancy kinds with the arms. And then the second tingle, he said, you know, the kind that you might sit on in a library. and the tears were already rolling down my face. He said, I'm going to keep walking around. You can take some notes if you want. As I was talking to him, and I could hear him walking in this hollow church, walking around, and he's mumbling to himself. He's talking to God, he's talking to me, he's talking to himself. Have you ever been in that situation before when you're talking to God? And you're talking to yourself? Anybody? And toward the end of the conversation, I get an email from the warehouse. 66 pews, but the president wants to keep 2. You can take 64 to New Orleans. And there are 10 tables that you can take as well. And take a bunch of the library chairs. They would work perfectly in a church. I said, hey, I just got an email. Pastor Ernest, I just got an email. He said, oh, those pews? He didn't even listen for a number. He said, those pews, if you could they be bright red? Our people love bright red. I don't know if you're affiliated with Central College, but our colors are red and white. Well, you don't put white in a chapel, you put red. I said, we have 64. And he said, sure you do. And I said, I'll send you a copy of the email. We brought him the pews, and we brought him the tables, and we brought him the chairs. He watched them unload from a semi-trailer. I made one call for a semi-trailer to bring a load of things from Pella. One phone call that lasted about 2 minutes. And the gentleman said, of course, why wouldn't we do that? It's the only thing that God would want us to do. One phone call, 2 minutes. And he watched us unload the pews, and he had church people standing behind him. And one lady said, they're just like our old ones. God taught me that day that he takes care of his church. I don't know who you think should be standing up here today, but I do know this. God takes care of his church. The first time I ever went to the hospital and sat with a family who lost someone, I had absolutely no idea what to say. I had no idea what to pray. I thought of all the things they taught you in seminary, they could surely teach you like something like now. I had no idea what I prayed, but all I know is I was holding the hand of a woman who had just lost her husband to a heart attack. And when my prayer was done, she looked at me and she smiled and she said, thy will be done. Isn't that what we've been taught? And I hugged her. And I realized her faith was somewhere up here, way beyond mine. And mine was down here. And I thought, how will I ever get to that kind of faith? And I think sometimes God says, don't worry. I'll throw in a few tests to make sure your learning. I don't say this very often, but for those of you who are older, when you have faith that can move mountains, thank you. Because there are younger people who are watching. See, it's not if the test will come, it's just when. And the biggest question is when you get to the bottom line, is how do you handle them? Do you hold on to God like Joseph did? This world, they meant it for evil, but God will work it for good. He does every time when you hold on to him. He'll work it for good. So when tests come, hum to yourself, he's got the whole world in his hands. And when tests come, no other people are watching you. Joseph's brothers certainly did. When they went to bed that night, they were all saying, he really is forgiving us. A childlike faith. He's got the whole world in his hands. We'll turn to prayer, and when I say, Lord, in your mercy, if you would respond with, hear our prayer. Let's pray together. God, we give you praise and we give you thanks for this day. You are a huge God with huge hands, and you hold us all, and you hold your church. For being a God who cares so much, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, there are so many prayer concerns. They're listed in the bulletin. I don't need to name them all by name. Lord, you know every name on that list. And you also know names of people in our hearts. Even before we speak them, you know that we are concerned about them. Lord, in your mercy, you are a healing God, and we pray for healing for people who are hurt, people who have diseases, people whose lives have been interrupted by flash floods, people whose homes have been destroyed by hurricanes, people who are in distress. We lift them up to you, Lord, in your mercy. We pray for missionaries, people who are out proclaiming the good news. We pray for our churches, that more and more people who come to our churches will know that you are good, that you are a good God, with an incredible gospel story that you love the world so much that you gave your son to save the world. We pray for all ministries who are proclaiming the good news of the gospel. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for a new pastor, that he will be embraced by love, that he will be welcomed with love, and that people will walk beside him in love. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, as we live out this week, we thank you for our nation. We thank you for our freedoms. We pray that we would live in a responsible way, caring for others and loving others as much as we love ourselves. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we are thankful that you hear us, and we close with the prayer passed down to us from your Son. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The offering and doxology, please. Receive this offering. If we could, we would climb in the plate ourselves, giving all of ourselves to you. Use these gifts to the glory of your kingdom. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let us join together in our closing hymn, number 370, Victory in Jesus.
Be steadfast in celebrating the Spirit's power, and may peace be your way in this